this morning in developing this worship. It's just amazing. The praise team, the songs. Why don't I see Ruth? Maybe she ran away. Okay, and Sandy Crancy for dealing with the stewardship moment. And I want to tell Bob Brewster that I want one of those little chimes. So when I'm trying to deliver a really interesting point, so what do we make of the story of the widow who is giving her last two copper coins into the offering? As we finish up our two-week series on stewardship, if I were a good Baptist preacher, I could construe this story to mean that everybody here needs to give more sacrificially, just like the widow Jesus is speaking about. And yet, that's not what the story really is talking about. Huh. Although I have to admit, growing up, I've almost heard almost every sermon on this talking about where the minister would use this text in an abusive manner to make people feel guilty about the amount of money that they were not tithing. Notice I said not giving, but not tithing. Because from a biblical standpoint, tithing stands for a 10% of what your annual income is in giving back to God. Now, I think Jesus is a very astute people watcher. Here we see Jesus point out, once again, the differences between the wealthy and the poor. This time, he's not chastising those who were wealthy, saying many wealthy were putting in lots of money. Maybe he was referring to the percentage of their giving was in proportion to their income. Or maybe he was meaning something else. If you were to go back just a little before this scripture, we read where Jesus had just finished criticizing the religious ruling class for their public acts of self-righteousness. Maybe he was coupling the amounts of money that the wealthy were putting into the temple treasury and seeing acts of self-righteousness through their giving. A couple of years ago, I was talking to a woman who had been raised in a wealthy African family. Then when she came to the States, she had a good job. She told me that her entire life that she had lived with enough and more than what she needed. But she also expressed to me that after reading this particular passage, she had been struggling for some months about how she, a person of means, could possibly give out of her poverty when she never really knew poverty. I believe she's asking a question that many of us in this country ought to be asking ourselves. How do we, who live in the wealthiest country in the world, give out of our poverty when most of us are more likely to be giving out of our abundance? Recent studies show that generally, the giving of the average Christian in this country to the average giving of a Christian giving to their church is only 2.5% of their income. I also noted that back during the Great Depression, the per capita giving was 3.3%. With the median household income in Port Orange at $57,521, how can this story about the poor widow giving her last two coins relate to us? It's easier for us to relate to they all were getting out of their wealth. Compared to 80% of the world, most of us, do not go to bed hungry. Most of us have a house with a bed in which we can sleep each night. Most of us have or have retired from jobs that help us meet our needs and our wants. Do most of us understand what it means to live in poverty? The 2016 Federal Guidelines for Living at Poverty Level for a Family of Six. Does anyone know what that figure might be? And if you work for the organization that deal with those kinds of programs, don't spell it out. Any idea what poverty level is for a family of six? Annual income? 16,000 is your bid? Do I hear higher? It is $32,580. That's what it takes just to get to the line of poverty in this country for a family of six. So out of all this plenty, are we truly able to give out of our poverty? In pondering this question, my memories took me back when I was a child. That's where these little bells would be nice. I'll have to speak to Bob about that for the second service. Much of my childhood was by governmental standards of that day lived just above poverty. For those of you who went through the Great Depression or in poorer families, I am sure that you can relate to some of the part to the story that I'm just about ready to relay to you. And maybe even to the plight of the poor widow in Jesus' story. So I recall one particular Christmas where we were so poor that there was not going to be any Christmas presents. There was no angel tree back in those days. It had been carefully explained to me, my sister and my brother, that financially it just was not possible for Mom and Dad to give us any presents. But my parents also made it very clear that Santa Claus would not forget us. But Mom and Dad just weren't able to give us those gifts. This also meant that the usual $1 per person in the family that each of us kids would get, so we could buy a present for each person, that source also dried up. Well, a few days before Christmas, as we three kids kept looking at the Christmas tree, which had no presents underneath it, we decided not to be defeated by the lack of money. After all, who says that you need money to give presents? I don't think that's in the rule book. After a very long and thoughtful discussion between us three, we concluded that we could hunt around the house and find things that already existed in which we could wrap up, some in actual Christmas wrapping, some in newspaper prints, and some in grocery sacks. A little hard now with plastic bags, but back in those days it was paper bags. It only took us one afternoon of imaginative thinking to fill that empty space underneath the tree. And you should have seen the surprised look on Mom and Dad's face when they walked through the door that day, coming home from work. On the morning of Christmas, we found that Santa had indeed not forgotten us. And there were a few extra gifts under the tree, which contained new clothing that my mother made, sewing late into the night after working a long day away at her job. To this day, the funny thing is, I don't remember what Santa brought me. I don't remember what the clothes looked like. that Mom made. But what I do remember are all the things that my sister, brother, and I had given each other. Gifts like empty whiskey bottles that we filled up with colored water. Old hats that we found in Mom's closet. Cooking utensils, mixing bowls, and even soap from the hall closet. These were all gifts that we had wrapped, put names on, and gave them to each other. But one gift in particular has become known in our family as the booby prize. It's a box of rocks that my little brother had wrapped and gifted to our sister. The gift became an annual gift giver. So my sister received that first year the box of rocks. She wrapped it up the next year and gave it to my brother. The next year, my brother took that bag of rocks, gave it back to my sister, back and forth, over years and years of doing this. It is such a cherished tradition between those two that a few Christmases ago, when my brother was not able to attend a Christmas gathering of my sister's family and mine, I went out and bought a bunch of polished rocks. See, I moved from the old rocks just down the street. I bought polished rocks and a vase, and I gave that to my sister in honor of our brother. What that Christmas showed us as a family was that Christmas wasn't about the ability to buy gifts for those that we love, but in the act of giving in and of itself. I realized that Christmas, just how closely our family could relate to the widow in today's story. It shaped a value for my sister, my brother, and for me that giving of ourselves is the most precious gift. This is what I see in the story of the widow's mite. When Jesus says, "But she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all that she had to live on," it isn't the amount of money that we give, but it is in the giving of all that we have, all that we are, that Jesus was pointing out. It is in the opening of our hearts and mind to a total trust that God can and will provide for our basic needs. When we do this, it doesn't matter if we're rich, middle class, or poor. For at this point, what we give to God is coming from within our heart. Giving out of our poverty. Amen.
Amen.